Jesus said, if I am weak, I should come to him. No one else can be my strength, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus said that if I fear, I should come to him. No one else can be my shield, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus said, if I am lost, he will come to me. And he showed me on that cross, he will come to me. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus strong and kind.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. It's great to see you all this morning. As you don't know me, my name is David Epp. I'm the pastor here. As Dan said, man, what a blessing it is. All this rain that we've been getting this week, seeing the Lord answer our prayers. It's wonderful. As we go into our service this morning, we're going to start with a portion of our scripture passage for our sermon today. So if you have your Bibles with you, please turn with me to Malachi. It is the last book of the Old Testament. You can find Matthew, just turn back one more page and you'll find Malachi. We're going to be reading in chapter 2, verses 17 to 3, verse 5. As I finish reading, I'm going to invite you to respond in saying thanks be. I will say, this is the word of the Lord, and I will ask you to respond in saying thanks be to God. It's Malachi chapter 2, verses 17. It says, you have wearied the Lord with your words. How have we wearied him, you ask? By saying, all who do evil are good in the eyes of the Lord, and he is pleased with them. Or where is the God of justice? I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. And then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. And then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in days gone by, as in former years. And so I will come to put you on trial, and I will be quick to testify against sorcerers, adulterers, and perjurers, against those who defraud laborers of their wages, who oppress the widows and the fatherless, and deprive the foreigners among you of justice. But do not fear me, says the Lord Almighty. This is the word of the Lord. We're continuing in our series on Elijah, and we're looking ahead to where to his prophecy and to him coming as John the Baptist, which we will discuss next week. Some heavy words and some heavy challenge in this book, but it is good, good for us. Coming up, just a few announcements as we get into our service this morning. We'll be having, this next Saturday, we'll be having the Spring Work Bee at 9 a.m., so if you want to come out and give us a hand, knocking off a few maintenance tasks around the church, we would love to get some help. One of the things that we announced this week on our rundown, just to give you guys a heads up, things are going to be changing a little bit with our library. Our plan is going to be to move the office upstairs, or my office, into that room. And so with part of that, we are going to be paring back some of the books, particularly our fiction section. We're going to be offering that to you guys to just, if anybody wants any of those fiction books, they're going to be out in the foyer over the next few weeks, so you can take whatever you would like. But we're going to just bring our library down to just resource books that you guys can use for Bible study, for personal Christian growth in your walk with God, parenting resources, family resources, all of those things. So we're going to be pulling our library down to a little bit more of a manageable size, and hopefully to utilize that room. There's been a few times where I hear a knock during the week, or somebody comes in the door, and then I hear a hello, and then somebody's actually upstairs, and I go running up, and by the time I can get there, they've closed the door, and they're already in their truck leaving. So the idea is to have the office upstairs, and the door's unlocked. People can come in, foot traffic, it's not like we get a lot of walk-ins in Rolla. Not a lot of people walking in Rolla, but we want to be able to have the doors unlocked when I'm here in the office, and then I know who's coming and going in the church, and just to be able to be a welcoming presence for anybody to come and talk to. So that is our desire with the library, but we will still have the library. Kathy's still going to be our librarian and taking care of that, so that is coming up. So we're going to be painting the library potentially as part of that, or doing some work, either just pulling the books. Either way, the library will be part of what our job is for the work bee. Coming up next Sunday will be our first Fellowship Sunday. So we're going to be having, we're just going to have it upstairs here. Rather than having people go downstairs, we're just going to set out, if you guys want, this is a bring your own, or kind of potluck style of bringing baking. So if there's a few ladies who just want to make a bunch of muffins or cookies or something to share for Sunday, that would be great. Even just come and talk to me about that. But that is the idea, is to have some baking to share and just hang around and spend some time together after church next Sunday. Coming up at the end of June, we're going to be having a community worship night with a bunch of our churches in Dawson Creek, and that will be at the Alliance Church again. That will be at 6 o'clock p.m., June 23rd. Are there any other announcements? Put that out there. All righty. Well, then let's invite our ushers forward, and we'll pray for our offering. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful day that you have given us. God, we thank you for the rain. We thank you for answering our prayers. And Lord, we know that, God, you are good. God, you are above all, over all things, Lord. That even rain is nothing for you to bring upon us. It is an easy thing. And God, we just thank you for being our sustainer, our caretaker. Lord, we just pray, God, as we give back to you today of our offerings, our tithes. Lord, we just pray that it would be a blessing to you. It would be pleasing in your sight. It would be for your glory and yours alone. In your name, amen.
Let's stand and turn to number 716, or you can see him overhead too. So.
Is sufficient for me. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. He gave his angels charge over me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. Charge over me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me.
Okay, we got that one done.
We should do it again and again until everybody starts clapping.
Okay, I guess the next one is only on overhead here. Fill my cup, Lord.
Shall run dry. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. There are millions in this world who are craving pleasures earthly things afford, but none can match the wondrous treasure that I find in Jesus Christ my Lord. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. So, my brother, if the things this world gives you leave hungers that won't pass away, my blessed Lord will come and save you if you kneel to him and humbly pray. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole.
And number 526. 526, the solid rock.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Thank you. You may be seated. I'd just like to read Psalm 1, and then we'll go to prayer. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the seat or in the path of the sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Lots of promises in that to look forward to, for and reasons for us to spur on and to follow him. Another page here yet. There we go. Is there any prayer requests? Pray for me too. I'm going to be all by myself. Okay, well, let's bow our heads. We have a lot to be thankful for. Father, I thank you for a beautiful day, Father. The beauty of this rain that you've sent, Father. We asked for it. It was not forecasted in the forecast, and here it is. What an awesome gift, Father. I thank you for the blessings you show us in your word, Father. Your word is alive, quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, Father. It goes right where it needs to be, Father, and I thank you for that. I thank you for your promises to us, for your love to us, Father. It's truly an incredible thing to have this personal, one-on-one relationship with you, Father. I thank you for that. I thank you for Jesus, that he provided this. He finished it. Father, I just pray that you would you go with us this morning, Father. I thank you for the time already we've been in worship to you, Father. I pray that this whole service would truly worship you. I pray that our worship would be acceptable to you. And Father, that we would truly honor your name. Father, I thank you too for Susie and the other ladies, Becky and Alfreda, that are going with her and going to help Carmen. I just pray that you'd truly bless and strengthen them, protect them as they travel. Look out for them, Father. We know that you know what we don't know, Father. And I just pray that you would look out for them and keep them safe, bring them home safe. And Father, may they have a good time there, but also a fruitful time for your kingdom, Father. I pray for Carmen. I pray that you'd bless her and her ministry there, Father, as she ministers so much to those children, to the next generation, Father. They take these truths home when they hear them, Father. And I just pray that there'd be a lot of truth happening there, Father, and people coming to you. Father, I pray too that you'd be with us guys, as we're going to be a little lonely there for a few weeks, but we'll be all right, Father. We'll be all right with you, Father, and I thank you for that. I thank you that we can trust in you and walk with you. I pray that you'd be with David this morning as he preaches your word, Father. Speak to our hearts, Father. I pray that your spirit would stir our hearts through your word, Father. I pray that you'd be with us this morning and bless this service, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I guess that just means I get to preach a little longer today. Did forget to mention that our church we're praying for in town today is the First Baptist Church in Terry Co. I'm just going to lift them up to prayer quick. Heavenly Father, I thank you for God, just what you were doing in all the churches in this area, in Dawson Creek and around. And Lord, we just lift up to you Dawson Creek First Baptist today, and Lord, that you would just be with Terry Co. as he gives the word today. Lord, that you would just continue to sustain him as he, Lord, as he preaches your word, brings your gospel truth to his congregation. Lord, and he also runs his own business. I just pray that you'd continue to just carry him, Lord, in his endeavors. And Lord, that we'd also just pray as they reach out to the college students that are nearby. God, I just pray that you would continue to work in them, that they would find a wonderful way in which to serve those college students and care for them. We just lift them up and pray for your blessing on their church today. In your name, amen. Well, as I've already said, this week we are beginning to wrap up our Spirit of Elijah series with really our final three sermons. We've spent a considerable amount of time since the beginning of January looking at the life and ministries of both Elijah and Elisha, as we've found in the book of 1 and 2 Kings. And we've been going through this series with the intent to discover and understand the significance of Elijah's role throughout the grand narrative of the Bible. We've got the context of his life, his ministry, and his miracles. And we've seen Elijah filling an important role in Israel's history of pointing God's people back to the one that they had promised to serve, back to the laws that God had given them to follow, but also pointing them forward to God's plan of redemption that would unfold in the person and work of Jesus Christ. And today we're taking a brief stop in Malachi as we journey our way over to the New Testament to examine Elijah's reappearance some really 870 years later from when he had first come on to the scene. And Malachi was the final prophet of the Old Testament. And it wouldn't be another 400 years until John the Baptist would come onto the scene in the spirit of Elijah. This prophecy of Malachi does give us a specific reference to the return of Elijah as the messenger preparing the way for the Lord and bringing about really a ministry of reconciliation. And so today we're looking to better understand Elijah through this prophecy of his return and his role to play in God's great plan of redemption. And so we're going to continue jumping to Malachi chapter 3, verse 13. We're going to finish off this prophecy from Malachi. And again, I'm gonna ask you to say thanks be to God at the end here. So Malachi chapter 3, verse 13 says this: "You have spoken arrogantly against me, says the Lord. Yet you ask, what have we said against you? And you have said, it is futile to serve God. What do we gain by carrying out his requirements and going about like mourners before the Lord Almighty? But now we can call the arrogant blessed, and certainly even evildoers prosper, and even when they put God to the test, they get away with it. And then those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. A scroll of remembrance was written in his presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. On the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty, they will be my treasured possession. I will spare them, just as a father has compassion and spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. Surely the day is coming, and it will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble, and the day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Not a root or a branch will be left to them. But for you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its rays. And you will go out and frolic like well-fed calves. And then you will trample on the wicked. They will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the decrees and laws I gave him at Horeb for all Israel. See, I will send the prophet Elijah to you before that great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. And he will turn hearts of the parents to their children, and the hearts of children to their parents, or else I will come and strike the land with total destruction. This is the word of the Lord. Well, I've been spending a lot of time in Malachi these last 2 weeks, and it's become one of my favorite books just in this time, because Malachi is speaking to the people of Israel, but he's also speaking to us as the church. I believe nearly all the issues that Malachi addresses in this short prophecy are issues really that we are currently facing today, even in the church. The problem that God is addressing through Malachi is, unfortunately, a lack of reverence for the Lord within the people of Israel. And I would argue that this too is a great problem in the church today, because a lack of reverence for God or lack of fear of the Lord quickly shows itself in a mishandling of God's commands, really for the benefit of oneself rather than for the Lord. Outwardly, our actions may have the appearance of righteousness, but they're a twist on what God has called us to do and be. And in that twisting of God's truth, in his words and his commands, our actions are actually self-serving rather than in worship of our Father in heaven. And so God is speaking through his prophet Malachi to address this problem among his people, helping to identify and to distinguish the truly righteous from the unrighteous, telling of that great and dreadful day of the Lord that is to come, and then presenting Elijah as a key person in God's plan of redemption and reconciliation. God is pointing us to the simple command that we often make so complicated. It's to fear the Lord, to revere his name, to love him with all of your heart, your soul, mind, and strength. That simple command. Well, in God's plea through Malachi for Israel to fear the Lord, it becomes apparent that really Israel has a misunderstanding of what constitutes a true member of God's people. Right? Israel has a misunderstanding of what constitutes a true member of God's people. And through each series of questions and statements, of which, you know, we've only touched on a couple of them in this book, God points out how the priests and the people of Israel have become really blasé in the way that they are handling God's commands and requirements. The ways in which they follow the Lord are contemptible even, offering blemished and diseased animals for sacrifice, doubting God's love, failing to revere the Lord, showing partiality in matters of the law, being unfaithful in marriage, marrying foreign women who serve other gods, divorcing their spouses, robbing God of their tithes and offerings. See, they thought they were following God in their actions, but really they were not following God's requirements very well or very closely at all. And God continually points out the flaws and the contradictions of their own logic, because they think that they are serving God. They're begrudgingly going about following God's commands and requirements. But yet, while they think that they are doing such a good enough job, even a great job of following the Lord, God points out that what they are actually doing is detestable to him, because it is all being done for selfish reasons and not out of a genuine love and reverence for God. Their actions, their thinking, their attitudes are riddled with misconceptions of God's character and misunderstandings of how God gives grace and blessings. They're claiming that God does not love them. They're wondering why God won't bless our offerings. God, what are you doing? In the same breath, they still say, all who do evil are good in the eyes of the Lord, and he's pleased with them. Or where is the God of justice? It's unclear if the first of these two statements is, you know, perhaps just a sarcastic way of saying, where is the God of justice? As they're saying, all who do evil are good in the eyes of the Lord. But whether that statement, you know, all who do evil are good in the eyes of the Lord, is made seriously, whether they're seriously saying that or they're sarcastically saying it, this same attitude points to the same heart problem that is pervading Israel. They don't see the point in following God. They can't even distinguish between the righteous and the unrighteous among themselves. They arrogantly say to the Lord, you have said it is futile to serve God. What do we gain by carrying out his requirements and going about like mourners before the Lord Almighty? But now we call the arrogant blessed. And certainly evildoers prosper, but even when they put God to the test, they get away with it. Because they don't understand why their version, their understanding of following God, is not working. They're not getting back what they're putting in. It's because they see their relationship with God as transactional. You know, if I do this, God will bless my life. You know, God, I've done this. Why am I not getting what is due me? And they don't see the difference between those who are arrogant and evil in the world and those who are actually, or who are following God. You know, they themselves, or they think themselves to be righteous in following the Lord. But God is saying to them, you know, you call the arrogant blessed, but you yourself are the arrogant. I've even just the definition of what arrogance is having or revealing an exaggerated sense of one's own importance or abilities. You know, they're saying, God, look at what I've done for you, and I haven't received an immediate reward. You know, how often even do we say that in our own prayers and speaking arrogantly to God? But God is pointing out how selfish and evil their actions really are. That he shows them just because they're God's people, Israel, that they are not walking righteously as they think that they are. Because Israel has a misunderstanding of what constitutes a true member of God's people. And God is showing them that there will be justice for the righteous and the unrighteous. For those who fear the Lord will get their blessing, and those who do not fear the Lord will face their judgment on the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord will be a day of distinguishing the righteous and the unrighteous, those that fear the Lord and those that do not. And God describes it as a great and yet a dreadful day. A great day for the righteous and a dreadful day for the unrighteous. Often the day of the Lord is presented to Israel actually as a dreadful day that is coming. In God's prophecy through Amos warns Israel for looking forward to this day. In Amos 5, verse 18, God says, "Woe to Amos is saying to them, woe to you who long for the day of the Lord. Why do you long for the day of the Lord? That day will be darkness, not light." A few verses later, in 21 to 23, says, I despise your religious festivals. Your assemblies are a stench to me. Even though you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And though you bring choice fellowship offerings, I will have no regard for them. Away with the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps. It sounds harsh. It pointedly is harsh. But this is how God feels when he is approached without reverence. When the only reasons that we're coming to him are out of our own selfishness. That Israel had a misunderstanding of what constitutes a true member of God's people. And so often, I believe, we can have that same misunderstanding even in the church. You know, just because you're sitting here in the shelter of the building within its walls today does not mean that the day of the Lord will be a great day for you. God hasn't drawn, you know, a magic line around the church building, you know, saying as long as you go to church on a Sunday, you will be spared on the day of the Lord. See, God is pointing into the people of Israel, because that is what they are thinking. They're thinking, we're God's people. We're good. You know, we're the righteous. Our neighbors, everywhere around us, they are the unrighteous. When we hear the day of the Lord speak, it's the great day for us. It's the dreadful day for them. But God is saying, look at the way you are serving me. Look at the way you are serving me today. He's pointing into the people of Israel, not just pointing out to the world. And today he's pointing into the people of the church, asking, okay, where is your reverence for God today? Where is your love for God today? For those who continue to walk in unrighteousness with no fear of the Lord, whether they are in the church or not, God says that he will be quick to testify against them, that they will be like stubble. And the refining fire of the day of the Lord will bring them quickly down to ashes. It says it will be a truly dreadful day for those people. But for the day, for those who fear the Lord, who walk in righteousness, who love the Lord with all their heart, with all their soul, mind, and strength, it says the sun of righteousness will rise with healing in its rays. And we get this glorious picture of God's light shining on us. Jesus is bringing us warmth, delight, comfort, healing. What a glorious picture. It's the joy that we will get to face. And those who fear the Lord will be as well-fed calves frolicking in a field. You know, anybody who's done any ranching, I'm sure, raised any kind of animals, you know, there's nothing quite like watching an animal that's being kept up in a stable for a period of time and then let out into an open pasture. And you just get to see the joy and the excitement as they run and jump and buck. And that will be the overwhelming excitement that we get to face, that we get to have as those who fear the Lord when Jesus our Savior returns. It will be a joyful, a great, wonderful day. And Elijah plays. Wow, I missed all the fun pictures. Yeah. You get the picture. Yeah. It's going to be good. But Elijah plays a crucial role in God's redemption plan. We're told that before the day of the Lord, God will send Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the hearts of the children to their parents, that his ministry and his return, his ministry in his return is a ministry of reconciliation. And this word turn is the term for repentance. The phrase of turning family members to one another, I believe, serves a double purpose. Primarily, it's not speaking about the fixing of relationship in family units, but it is speaking to the reconciliation between God and his creation. It's the reconciliation of our Father, of our Heavenly Father and his children. It's our reconciliation of our covenant renewal with Yahweh. And that in itself is an exciting thing of hope, that we get to be reconciled to the God who created us, who we have turned away from. And the secondary purpose that we can take from Elijah's return is in the reconciliation, the renewal of family units, of parents to children and children to parents. One of the first commands that God gave to his creation, that he gave to Adam and Eve, was to go be fruitful and multiply, to grow with your families. God's design in creation was that there would be a close relationship in families, just as he had designed a close relationship between himself and his creation, his children, that there would be this intimate relationship. That is his design for families even today. However, we see that throughout Scripture, throughout history, and even in our culture today, that the more selfish, self-centered, or self-serving that a culture or people will get, the more we witness a decline and dissolution of family in a society. And we see that, say, very much coming even to a peak even today. That God's command to be fruitful and multiply was also intended as a blessing. As God's people would turn and follow him, that they were met with the blessing of families growing and thriving together, of relationships being healed. That when we turn in repentance, that there is a blessing that starts to take place in families. And I can even say that in my own life, in my own relationship with my mom, of there being division, of seeing how selfishness and brokenness and sinfulness in our lives tore a family apart, broke my parents' marriage apart. And yet, I had to put aside my own my own anger and ask God, say, I'm going to walk in your forgiveness, Jesus. And because of that, because of my own repentance, I've been able to see my own family and relationships being restored together. See, when humanity walks in sin and unrighteousness, we see the curse of sin in families. The curse of sin break down families. But repentance actually will build them up. In the Gospel of Luke, God sends an angel to Zechariah, the future father of John the Baptist, and tells him that this prophecy will be fulfilled in his son. In Luke 1:17, says that, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And this was part of Elijah's job in preparing the way for the Lord, that Elijah would come with this message of repentance, so that God's creation could be reconciled to him, so that the hearts of the disobedient would turn and follow the wisdom of the righteous, that their hearts needed to be ready and prepared for Jesus, so that through his life, through his death, and his resurrection, God's children could be reconciled to the Father. And it is interesting that both Moses and Elijah are mentioned here at the end of this book, especially right before we go into the New Testament. But Moses and Elijah are mentioned in tandem at the end of Malachi's prophecy, and that these are also the last words of the Old Testament before Jesus and John the Baptist come onto the scene some 400 years later. The final two statements of Malachi point the readers to remember. To remember the law of Moses and not to miss the message of Elijah. That these two are the most authoritative prophets in the Old Testament. By pointing to Moses, the reader is to continually hold the Torah, or the books of the law, the first five books of the Old Testament, as the Word of God, to remember how God had acted, how he had revealed himself to his people. And Elisha also represents God's mighty works and actions throughout the times of the kings, the writings of the prophets, and Israel's exile and return. These two men pointed to God's continual redemptive work throughout the entire history of Israel. Throughout all of the Old Testament, these two prophets summed it all up. And I believe that's also why we find them both being present with Christ at his transfiguration on the mountain, which we will address in a couple weeks' time. But their presence in this passage is to help Israel remember what God has done and remember what he's going to do. Right, remember what he's done and remember what he's going to do. And last week, Michael shared with us the importance of keeping a right view of God. Understanding and knowing that God is the creator of everything, that he is above all things, that he is over all things, and that it's important that we keep a high view of our God. Because it can be all too easy to follow in the way of the Israelites and begin thinking that the world revolves around me and that what I believe to be fair and just in my own life. It's all too easy to start thinking that our relationship with God is transactional. If I give my life for God, I'm expecting some blessings in return. I'm expecting to be living in, at least some kind of wealth, free from hardships. I'm expecting to have some good health. I shouldn't be suffering from diseases or something. I'm expecting to have this easy life, free from hardships. And it's easy to look around at the world around us, and wonder, what's the point? There are people that are so much worse than me. And yet their lives seem to be doing so much better. They have everything that I want and more. They've got the fancy house. They've got side-by-sides. They've got I don't know what it is that but it's easy to look at the world and say, why does God bless them? Yet I'm giving my life to following God, and I'm facing poverty. I'm facing disease. I'm facing something, some kind of hardship. But our reward is not here in this sin-filled world. Our reward comes in being reconciled to our Father in heaven, where we will get to experience a life filled with blessing. Free from sin, free from pain, from disease and injustice. That is the eternal life that we get to face, that we get to look forward to. Because God gave us a simple command. It's to love him with everything in our being. And that is the greatest commandment in Scripture. And our obedience and following the Lord needs to start there. Because following Jesus and walking in righteousness, it all flows from that simple, single command. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. We are to fear the Lord. The fear of the Lord is simply a reverence for God. To maintain a high view of God from a position of humility for ourselves. Understanding him and his transcendence as God over all things. And so I encourage you to ask yourself today, are the gifts that I give God, whether that is financially, my offerings, my time, even my resources, whether those be tithes, charitable giving of some kind, helping others, serving in the church, serving in my community, are these things for God or are they for me? Are they for his glory or for my own? And ask yourself, would this gift, the gifts that you are bringing, would this gift that I am bringing to the Lord actually be pleasing in his sight? Am I giving him the best that I have to offer? Or am I keeping the best for myself? As it says earlier in Malachi, the Lord is chastising the Israelites for bringing him blemished sacrifices. They are to bring the best, the spotless lamb, and yet they are bringing and sacrificing to the Lord blind animals, diseased animals. And he says, why would you give this to me? Where's the honor due me as Father, as your God? Why wouldn't you try giving this gift to your governor, to your king, your prime minister, whoever it may be, would they find it pleasing? Ask yourselves. See, after God pointed out all the arrogance of those in Israel, it says that those who feared the Lord talked with each other. Those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. And a scroll of remembrance was written in his name concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. This is Revelation 21:27. And so nothing impure will ever enter it, speaking of heaven, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Is your name written in the scroll of remembrance? Is it written in the Lamb's book of life? If not, I encourage you, as Elijah has said, as Elijah's job was to come and bring us to repentance, to turn to God. It's not like you're stuck in being one or the other. We all come starting from a place of unrighteousness, of being enemies before God. See, in this world we will face many difficulties, and patience and perseverance can be difficult to hold on to. Our reward is not here on this earth, but it is in heaven. God did not leave us without hope in this world, but he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, so that we as children could turn from our sins and be reconciled to our heavenly Father. As I said, we've all started from the same place. It's Colossians 1:21-23. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. We were all there, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in the faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. Elijah brought us a great message. All you have to do is turn. All you have to do is come to the Lord. The day of the Lord is coming for all who fear the Lord. And this is a day that we get to look forward to. And so don't lose hope as well when looking at the world around you. Because God will act again. And I like what Richard Patterson had to say in his commentary of Malachi, in just giving us this hope, looking back at what God has already done and looking forward to what he is going to do. The assurance of this coming day of the Lord, Lord's visitation for justice and judgment, is rooted in salvation history as revealed in the Bible. For example, God has already acted in the Genesis flood. God has already given the Hebrews an exodus from Egypt. God has already acted in the contest against Baal on Mount Carmel. And God has already acted at the cross of Jesus Christ. The righteous have every reason to be confident that God will act again on their behalf. And this brings us to the real purposes of biblical eschatology, purposes that include engendering hope within the Christian church, affording the righteous an opportunity for mutual comfort and encouragement, and prompting expectant and godly living among the people of God, and fostering a spirit of willing service in the name of Christ, and exhorting the persecuted Christian church to patient endurance. The righteous have every reason to be confident that God will act again on our behalf. There is hope, and we can be patient, and we can persevere. And so my encouragement to you is this: to remember what God has done in this world already from the beginning of time. If you don't know what he has done, read his word. It's full of God acting within our world. That he is the creator and ruler over all things. He is magnificent in his transcendence over all. And we are so blessed that he is personal, relational, and intimate with his creation. That he has made a plan to redeem us from this world of sin and trouble. So turn your eyes and follow him. Keep his death, his burial, and resurrection on the forefront of our minds so that you will remember that he has reconciled you to the Father. Remember what he has done, and remember what is still to come. That in the hard times of life, remember that Christ is coming. And that on that great and dreadful day, that those who follow Jesus will feel the warmth of his light. We'll get to go out frolicking like well-fed calves. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. God, that you are so personal to us, for us, and intimate with us. God, that you have spoken to us, that you have given us your word here in the Bible, your scriptures, that we can look through thousands of years of history and see how you have acted and you have saved your people. You have saved those, Father, who continue to be your righteous remnant. And Lord, I just pray, God, if we do find ourselves today, as we ask and we examine our own hearts, if we do find ourselves sitting in this camp of the unrighteous, Lord, I just pray that we would turn, knowing, Jesus, how you have already paid the penalty for our sins, the penalty for these unrighteous acts. God, that we can turn, that we can look to you, we can have a fear of you, a reverence for your name. God, and that we can come before you and approach you with confidence, knowing that, Jesus, you have reconciled us, that you have made us without blemish, free from accusation before the Father. God, you are such a good God, and we thank you, God, for acting through your Son, Jesus, to bring us to a place of salvation, God, where we can come before you. And Lord, I just ask that you would help us, convict us, God, point us, God, in the ways that we can continue to walk in righteousness. God, where we need to improve. God, knowing that you have grace for us as we go through our week. God, that we know that we have your forgiveness. Lord, help us to walk in your ways today. In your name we pray. Amen. Invite our worship team up for one closing song. I do encourage you as well to stay for our Sunday school following our service starting at 12.
Not on?
Now we're on. Thank you, David. True encouragement. Let's stand and turn to number 705, or it is also on the overhead. It is well with my soul.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul.
It is well,
it is well.
Should come, let this blessed assurance
Just to close us in these last few words in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 to 19. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Amen. I encourage you to have a blessed week. And if you're an Oilers fan, I will be here all week. Same, you know, either way. Canucks, Oilers, come visit me, whoever, you know, whatever you need. Yes, Carolyn.
Every now and again, I'm given some veggies, and I'm sort of tidying them up, and there's some out by the coffee maker, so please take them. I don't want to take them home again. Okay, so help yourself.
Free vegetables in the foyer. By all means, take them. We are going to start Sunday school in about 10 minutes, so please feel free to grab some coffee and chat. I'll see you in a minute.